building of a cathedral tested the skills and ingenuity of the cathedral builders to the limit. Yet, the ideas and methods that they used had barely changed since Roman times.
In fact, the style they're built in the early period is called Romanesque. It's based on the kind of arch that the Romans used, the round arch. The shape was always based on a circle, often a full semicircle, sometimes a section of one, or with the curve slightly distorted. It was simple, but limited.
Arches in a style known as Romanesque can be sturdy, even chunky. A whole building made of these arches has a muscular, powerful effect. But in the middle of the 12th century came an idea that would change all this, a revolution in design and construction that would raise cathedral building to new levels of sophistication.
It was a style that would become known as Gothic. It was born in France at Saint-Denis, near Paris. Here, the visionary abbot Suger rebuilt part of the abbey church, burial place of the French kings. He was using a new kind of arch, not a round arch, but a pointed one. But his aims went beyond this.
For Abbot Suger had a vision. He wasn't simply after something bigger and grander. He had a theological rationale for his new design. It was a theology of light.
For medieval thinkers, light had a profoundly religious meaning. The embodiment of spirit, one writer called it.
The work should brighten our minds so they travel through the light to the true light of Christ. In seeing this light, the dull mind is resurrected from darkness.
Abbot Suger and his unnamed master mason had glimpsed the possibilities of the pointed arch. It's both stronger and more flexible than a round one. Both the shape and width of a pointed arch can be varied in more ways. And the weight of a building naturally moves downwards and outwards in a shallow curve, closer to that of a pointed than a round arch. This simple difference was to change the entire way cathedrals were conceived, designed, and built. The second Sunday in June 1144 may have had a greater effect on architecture than any other day in history. At the dedication service, bishops from all over Europe gathered at Saint-Denis to witness a building designed to evoke the experience of heaven more completely than anything before it.
The bishops were awestruck. They had seen the future. There was one dissenting voice. The monk Bernard of Clairvaux saw in such splendor nothing but worldly distraction.
O vanity of vanities, but more folly than vanity. Every part of the church shines, but the poor man is hungry. The walls are clothed in gold, while the children of the church remain naked.
But such asceticism was out of step with what the mighty bishops wanted. Gothic and stained glass made a perfect marriage. Cathedral builders vied to make ever larger windows, to make wall spaces ever smaller. Some buildings became mere skeletons of stone. But these structures, with their great roofs and ceilings pushed outwards as well as downwards, they needed strong support.
The masons came up with a new kind of structure. The flying buttress takes the weight of the building out and down, leaving its walls free for all kinds of possibilities. Windows could get bigger, the structure itself could get higher, and arches of all kinds could be more delicately decorated.
The flying buttress siphoned off the weight from the walls of the nave, leapfrogging the side aisles as it did so. Where practical necessity met aesthetic adventure came a strange, fantastic beauty. For more than 300 years, from the late 12th century to the early 16th, cathedral architecture in England enjoyed a golden age.
Windows make the upper parts of the cathedral bright, with their vivid and various colours imitating the rainbow. Hard without, but like a honeycomb within. It seems to be a thing not of art, but of nature, holding people's minds in suspense as they wonder. Soaring and lofty, clear and resplendent.
The last part of a cathedral to be built was the stone ceiling under the roof level, known as a vault. Here at Gloucester, you can see how as masons grew bolder, their vaults became ever more ambitious.
The great breakthrough came with the invention of the rib vault. These small diagonal arches made it possible to build vaults that were bigger and higher.
Though at first they were built to strengthen the vault and hide ugly joins, in the 13th century, masons began to exploit the purely decorative effects of these ribs.
They add these diagonal ribs, which are called tiercerons, that are much more decorative, simply about making patterns. Soon you're in what we call the decorated style. You're heading through the 14th century, and people start to get really carried away. They add little short ribs, which are just there to make three-dimensional patterns on a curved stone roof.
In the cloisters at Gloucester, mastery in stone and aesthetic ambition reach a climax. The fan vault must rank as one of the marvels of the English Gothic style. These trumpet-like cones, covered in carved patterns, were unlike anything seen before.
The fan vault dispenses with ribs altogether. It's just a skin of carved stone, a few inches thick, like an eggshell, yet the effect has all the delicacy of lace.
It was a kind of eureka moment for the medieval masons. Instead of ribs, they simply built a smooth, curved surface, spreading out evenly in all directions, like an inverted dome. The surface was covered with repeated patterns, reflecting those that ran over the walls and windows below. Again, no maths or physics were needed, just what worked. The idea is inspired, but the engineering not much more complex than constructing an igloo. The fan vault was one of the last great innovations in three centuries of Gothic.
To walk through an English cathedral is to walk through the history of England and its architecture. Here at Ely, for example, the great round arches of the nave with their massive pillars date back to the conquering Normans. Walk on, and you enter the 13th century and the pointed arches of Gothic. Further still, and you get to the very end of the medieval era with its passion for carving that looks less like stone than crystallized foam.
But the time would come when the great cathedrals no longer exerted the same fascination. The intellectual and religious passion that had fired the medieval builders was changing. Wealthy patrons put their money into private chapels rather than great churches. And in the 1530s, the religious world of England was turned upside down. Protestants and Puritans put hammers and chisels to a very different use.